It seems like every day I ask the question, what in the world is going on? You know, we're living in a time that just does not make a lot of sense to almost any of us. Every value we have cherished is now under assault. The government's trying to legalize every immoral, evil, and unethical practice, while at the same time trying to shut down everything, or at least greatly intrude on everything that teaches religious values or personal responsibility, and especially if it teaches absolute truth. At the same time, they're promoting homosexual and transgender lifestyles and practices as being normal, while trying to destroy the traditional family structure and especially destroy the role of fathers. They're trying to introduce racism and division through the critical race theory, and trying to pass it off as if it's something good for everybody. And the whole thing about it is if you are opposed to this radical agenda, then you are the one that are censored and completely shut out, or the word they use now, canceled in this woke society. What in the world is going on? And then when you consider that the far left is trying to do everything that they can to rig elections so they can remain in power, and how they've usurped our civil rights and liberties in their COVID overreach, it just makes you want to throw up your hands and quit. Not to mention the fact that they got the media lying to us almost every single day, trying to convince us that what we know to be false is true, and what we know to be true can't even be talked about in circles anymore. What in the world is going on? And then put on top of that the personal issues that every one of us have. Right now, you may be struggling with bills, with their health problems, or have family relationships that are going sour. We're dealing with runaway inflation. Gas prices are out of control. And on and on and on and on and on the list goes. So the question is, with everything that's going on, with life as we know it today, here in 2021, I want to ask a very serious question. Are you supposed to have peace and joy in today's world? Is it even possible to have peace and joy in 2021? And of course, the emphatic answer is yes. Peace and joy are the results of living a life in Christ. They are not based on what is happening around us. God has given us peace and joy. He gave them to us. He gave them to us as benefits of having a relationship, a personal relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. But it's important that we understand what we're talking about, because peace is not the absence of conflict. It is the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. That's what peace is all about. And joy is not happiness. We know that happiness is temporary. It's completely dependent on what's happening around you in any given moment. Sometimes things that are happening around us make us sad, make us not happy. But that's not joy. Happiness focuses on the day, on the events of the day, while joy focuses on the person of the Jesus Christ, our Savior. Joy is a gift that comes from the Holy Spirit. So that's what I want to imply to you today. If you haven't already caught the drift, if you didn't know, we can enjoy peace and embrace joy in the presence of Jesus Christ. As I said, both of those are gifts from God. That's what God wants us to have. Look at what Jesus said. He said, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be made full." David, when he was confessing his sins after committing adultery with Bathsheba, he confessed it to God, and this is how he prayed. This is the request. He said, "To God, restore to me the joy of thy salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit." Jesus said, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace." In the world, you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world. Holy Spirit, speaking through Paul, said these words, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then, of course, the most probably one of the most famous verses on peace and the personal favorite of many people, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. You see, Jesus and God want us to have and experience peace and joy. Today, what I want to do is show you four actions that you can take so that you can not only live in joy and peace, but so that you can flourish, embrace, and enjoy a life of joy and peace with God. Now, keep in mind, when we talk about these four actions today, none of them are prioritized. It's not saying that the first one's most important or second. None of them are prioritized. They're all equally important. You must do all four, all day, every day. And the result will be a life of joy and peace. So the first action that I want you to see is to linger in gratitude. We've all prayed fervently for something. It may, no matter what the specific item is, it could have been a health issue, it could have been a financial issue, it could have been a salvation issue, it could be praying for a restoration of a family relationship because of rebellious children. Whatever it is, we pray, and we pray, and we pray fervently for that, for whatever that something is that we need or we want or desire. And if it's God's will, He will answer that prayer at the perfect time. And what do you do when you receive that prayer then? I mean, that answer to that prayer. You respond joyfully and thankfully. And that's good. But the problem is, after we thank God for answering that prayer, our tendency is to move on to something else. God, that's a good thing to do. Be thankful for the answered prayer. But God wants us to thank Him and not move on. God wants us to remain for a while in a period of sustained gratitude. Listen to what He says in Colossians. It says, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him, having been firmly rooted and now being built up in Him and established in your faith, just as you were instructed, and overflowing with gratitude. I want you to focus on those last three words, overflowing with gratitude. And that ought to be our be a characteristic of our lifestyle. We linger in gratitude. Instead of just experiencing a short-lived burst of gratitude, let this pleasure of thankfulness flow freely as you recall all that God has done for you. And you know one of the best ways to linger in gratitude? Tell other people what God's done for you. You know, we should be given what I call praise reports all the time. God is constantly doing things for us. And that's great. But we need to tell somebody about it. Not only will it bless you, but it will also encourage others. But more importantly, it pleases God. Again, go back to the Old Testament verse in 1 Chronicles. It says, oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon His name. Make known His deeds among the people. That, look, God wants every one of us to continue to bring our gratitude to Him. What is it that when we linger in gratitude, what are we being thankful for? Man, thank Him for the gift, the free gift of eternal life that He has given us through His Son, Jesus Christ. Thank Him for the things He's done for us, showering us with blessings, providing for our every need, protecting us from both known and unknown dangers. Thank Him for being the God that He is. Thank Him for loving us the way that He does, in spite of ourselves. You ever thought about it? God knows us perfectly. He knows us inside and out. He knows everything we do, everything we don't do, and He knows the motivation and the attitude behind it all. And in spite of all that, He still loves us. This perfect, unconditional love. We've got so much to thank Him for. That's why David wrote it this way. Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to Him with psalms. We got reason to be shouting to God. He has saved us from eternal damnation by sending His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's in addition to everything else He's ever done. Look, if God's never done anything for you, you ain't got no reason to shout. But if He's done even one thing, you ought to be shouting. And we know that God has done much, much more than that. God don't want doubting Christians. He won't shouting Christians. That is how we linger in gratitude. Why is it we just sit there and act like God never done anything for us? Our thankfulness and our attitude of gratitude will bless us doubly. It blesses us with happy memories of every time we think about the answered prayer that He has given us, but it also blesses us with the delight of sharing God's kingdom that is not shaken by the decisions or trends of society or government. Look, I can't answer what's going on, but I can tell you this, God is still on the throne, He's still in control, and one day we're going to see the victory come in spite of what everybody's trying to do in government and in the far left. We got reason to be thankful. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service. That word acceptable really is better translated in English as reasonable. Offer to God a reasonable service with reverence and awe. So the first action that you need to take to live a life of peace and joy is to linger in gratitude. Second action, do not worry. Now my Aunt Dot, she was one of my favorite aunts. She was just a fantastic lady. But she had one major negative characteristic. She was a worry wart. In fact, she is the champion of worry warts. No matter what was happening around her, Aunt Dot was always seen to be frazzled and frantic. If I heard her once, I heard her say 1,000 times, "I'm just a nervous wreck." Now, when I first started hearing that as a little boy, I had no idea what she meant. But that's what she always said. Well, one particular time when she was at our house, we were out playing. I was about 4, maybe 5 years old, and I got bit by my neighbor's dog. And I got bit rather badly. In fact, he sunk his teeth very deeply into my thigh. And it was bleeding profusely. Mama was getting ready to take me to the hospital because we knew it was going to have to require stitches maybe or something, but the bleeding wouldn't stop. While she was getting ready, Aunt Dot had me sitting on the bathroom. She picked me up and set me on the bathroom counter trying to get me all cleaned up. And I remember it just as clearly as it was yesterday, looking at her and saying in my innocent little 4-year-old voice, "I'm a nervous wreck." Do not worry. And probably the most famous passage of Scripture on this particular topic is Jesus talking when He gave His Sermon on the Mount. Look at these selected verses from chapter 6. "Do not worry for your life as to what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor for your body as to what you shall put on. And which of you by worrying can add a single cubit to his lifespan? Do not worry." Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. Now, I want you to look at those verses. I want you to look very carefully, because I want you to notice one important detail about this familiar passage of Scripture. This is a command. Jesus said, you know, you really shouldn't worry. Yeah, why don't you not worry? He didn't say any of that. He said, do not worry. Three times in those few verses, he issued that command, do not worry. Now, this is a command not to burden us or to condemn us. On the contrary, it's a very gracious command that is given to set us free from worldly cares. You know, in the extended part of this passage that we just quoted from, Jesus was talking about how God feeds the birds of the air even though they don't plant any crops. He talks about how he clothes the lilies of the field in great splendor. And he says in that passage, he asked a rhetorical question. Since God loves us more than birds and flowers, how much more will he provide us everything that we need? And then Jesus reminds us in verse 32 that God knows, our Heavenly Father knows everything that we need. So instead of worrying, he tells us to seek his kingdom and his righteousness, because verse 33 says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. As you do, your perspective changes. As you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, everything changes. Worldly pursuits become secondary to advancing the kingdom of God and advancing your personal relationship with him and becoming more like him. So instead of worrying, spend your time and energy in developing your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Paul said it this way, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. In other words, worry about nothing, pray about everything. Do not worry. It's a command from Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus taught us that if we love him, we will obey his commands. Isn't that what he said? If you love me, you will keep my commands. So logic dictates that if we worry, we're not keeping his command. And if we're not keeping his command, obviously at that moment we don't love him. You know what else we do when we worry? We're sitting there saying to God, God, you can't handle this problem. You need me to help you fix it. Now, which of us would have the audacity to even suggest that? But that's exactly what we do when we were created to enjoy the presence of God. In the present, in the now, in the day, today, as we entrust our future into his care and into his hands, worry will shorten our life and will rob us of the joy and peace in which God wants us to flourish in his presence. So if you want to live a life of peace and joy, linger in gratitude and do not worry. But there's a third action. Suffer well. Now let me explain. Look, every one of us are a child of God. Someday, our faith will become sight, and we will see God as he really is. And we will not only see him as he really is, we're going to be just like him. But until that day comes, every one of us are still under construction. In fact, John said it this way in 1 John. He said, beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as of yet what we shall be. We know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we will see him just as he is. although in Christ today you are a new creation and you are being conformed to His image, it doesn't erase the essence of who you are. But the good news is that you identified with Jesus and you're becoming more and more like Him. That tells us quite simply, while our future is secure and glorious, while the penalty of sin has been completely removed forever, your present is not always going to be easy. Hardships await. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Paul said it this way in Romans 8. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, heirs also, heir of God and fellow heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with Him in order that we might also be glorified with Him. Jesus said it this way, blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men cast insults at you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you on account of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. So what are these two texts teaching us? They're teaching us that we are a member of the family of God. We are a child of God. Therefore, we are fellow heir with Christ. That means we're going to share His inheritance. We're going to share His glory. That's good news. However, there's another side to that coin. If we are going to share Christ's glory, then we also must share His suffering. He said, you will be persecuted. You will face hardship. You will suffer on account of me. So if we're going to share in His suffering, you know what we ought to do? Suffer well. Suffer well. Polycarp was a Christian of the very first century. He was martyred by the Romans because he refused to denounce Christ and worship Caesar. At the age of 80, he was burned at the stake. In the midst of all the fire engulfing him, everyone around him heard him cry out from the fire, praising God that he was found worthy to suffer for Jesus Christ. Suffer. We're going to suffer, so suffer well. Knowing you're going to suffer, knowing you're going to face persecution, search for Jesus in the midst of your struggles and in the midst of the hard times. In other words, suffer well. Ask Jesus to help you suffer well in a manner worthy of the King's household. Everything you endure will help you become more like Jesus if you learn to suffer well. Now, when I talk about suffering well, in my mind, a picture of a woman in labor comes to my mind. The process of her giving birth. During that labor, she endures intense pain, almost to the point of the pain being unbearable. And as one labor pain abates, there's a brief period of respite comes. But then shortly, here comes another pain, even more intense, and coming at a quicker pace. The pain arrives stronger and stronger and stronger. And in that delivery room, or in that wherever she happens to be, there's much crying and screaming because of the suffering she endures. But then the baby is born. And in spite of all of the blood, sweat, and tears, every bit of that turns to joy because she's holding her newborn baby. Suffer well. Remember, the ultimate goal is what David said in Psalm 17. As for me, I shall behold thy face in righteousness. I will be satisfied with thy likeness when I awake. So while we're here on this earth facing all of the stuff that we have to face, if we want to live a life of peace and joy, We must linger in gratitude. We must not worry. We must suffer well. But there's a fourth one. Fourth action that Jesus tells us to take to have that peace and joy. Do not fear. Listen to what God told the prophet Isaiah. He said, "Thus says the Lord, who made you and formed you from the womb, who will help you. Do not fear, O Jacob, my servant." You ever realize God's been involved in your life even from before you were born? Because you are His child, you can count on His promise to help you and be with you as you journey on this earth, no matter what situation you're facing. Let me remind you of some of the promises that God has given us throughout His Word. Again, to Isaiah 41:10, He said, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And everybody remembers what He told Joshua. He said, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Do not fear. We have absolutely nothing to fear. No matter what we face, no matter how strongly the enemy opposes us, we gain victory by trusting in God. Again, David wrote in the Psalms, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth should change, though the mountains slip into the sea, no matter what's going on around us, no matter if the whole world is falling apart, and it is, we will not fear because God is our refuge. God is our strength. He is our ever-present help." God loves us more than you'll ever realize. He loves us more than I can. It's beyond comprehension how He loves us and how much. Do you realize that God is head over heels in love with you? We say, "For God so loved the world." Yes, He loves the world, but He knows you by name. He loves you. You got a personal relationship with Him. And because of that perfect love with which God loves you, there is absolutely no room for fear in your life, nor is there no need for it. The Bible teaches us that there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves punishment. And the one who fears is not perfected in love. Jesus said it this way many, many times while He was here on this earth. "Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful." When we focus on the circumstances that are around us, when we try to control every detail of our life, weeds of worry and fear quickly spring up and choke the life out of us. No matter what you're facing, no matter what the problem is, no matter what storm you're facing, there are only two ways to respond to a storm. You respond in fear or you respond in faith. You can't do both. You respond in fear or you respond in faith. What's the difference? Fear focuses on the storm. Faith focuses on the Savior. When you find yourself afraid, turn away from the storm and turn to the Savior, the one who is lovingly present with you at every stage of life. Lean hard on His presence. Trust Him to help you today and all the days of your life. Listen to His words of comfort as He whispers in your ear. Listen to what He's saying. This passage in Isaiah happens to be my most favorite passage of all of the Bible. And it's one that I go to quite often when I'm facing a storm. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Now, I want you to notice in that passage, God didn't say that we were never going to be in a fire. God never said that we were going to be in floodwaters up to our neck. He said, but when you are, they will not overtake you. You will not drown. You will not burn, because I am there. I have redeemed you, called you by name. You are mine. So can you have peace and joy during difficult, trying times, when your circumstances seem unmanageable, when you don't have any idea what's going to happen, when you don't know what to do? Can you? Yes, you can. You can experience a profound and reassuring peace with overflowing joy despite what's happening around you. For you see, peace and joy is based on the security we have as a child of God. So to live a life of peace and joy, lingering gratitude, do not worry, suffer well, do not fear. These four actions, they will not guarantee you that you're never going to have troubles or tribulations ever again, because you are. But they will guarantee that you will not lose your joy. You will not lose your peace. They will enable you to enjoy peace and embrace joy in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, who will never leave you nor ever forsake you. And so, when you do this, you can truly say, it is well with my soul. Father God, we know that we're living in troubled times. Lord, we know that your presence on earth is being strongly attacked. We know that there's spiritual war going on, but we know you've already won the battle. And so we know that you have given to us permanent joy and peace because of our relationship with you. And Father, that is why we can say, it is well, in spite of the storm raging around us. Father, right now, as people are listening to this message, wherever they may be, many of them are facing personal storms. But help us to remember that even though the world around us seems to be crumbling, even though the storm is approaching and hitting us with full fury, because of the fact that we are a child of yours, your joy and your peace remain constant. Father, right now, I simply pray for each person, whether we're looking at a societal problem or whether they're facing a personal problem, may they feel your presence like they've never felt or experienced before. And in spite of the storm, with all the winds and the rains and all the howling and thunder and lightning, may we be able to say, with a smile on our face, it is well with my soul. And it is well because of you. Father, may your Holy Spirit speak to the hearts of each one. May they respond in whatever way you're calling them. Some need to respond by accepting you as Lord and Savior. Some need to respond by renewing and rededicating their life for you. Some need to respond by simply putting their trust in you in the specific situation of the storm they face. So may they turn from the storm, turn to you, and run to your open arms. Your will be done, Father. For this we pray in your name. Amen. The altar is open. You come as we stand together and we sing. We'll see y'all Wednesday night. It seems like every day I ask the question, what in the world is going on? You know, we're living in a time that just does not make a lot of sense to almost any of us. Every value we have cherished is now under assault. The government's trying to legalize every immoral, evil, and unethical practice, while at the same time trying to shut down everything, or at least greatly intrude on everything that teaches religious values or personal responsibility, and especially if it teaches absolute truth. At the same time, they're promoting homosexual and transgender lifestyles and practices as being normal, while trying to destroy the traditional family structure and especially destroy the role of fathers. They're trying to introduce racism and division through the critical race theory, and trying to pass it off as if it's something good for everybody. And the whole thing about it is if you are opposed to this radical agenda, then you are the one that are censored and completely shut out, or the word they use now, canceled in this woke society. What in the world is going on? And then when you consider that the far left is trying to do everything that they can to rig elections so they can remain in power, and how they've usurped our civil rights and liberties in their COVID overreach, it just makes you want to throw up your hands and quit. Not to mention the fact that they got the media lying to us almost every single day, trying to convince us that what we know to be false is true, and what we know to be true can't even be talked about in circles anymore. What in the world is going on? And then put on top of that the personal issues that every one of us have. Right now, you may be struggling with bills, with their health problems, or have family relationships that are going sour. We're dealing with runaway inflation. Gas prices are out of control. And on and on and on and on and on the list goes. So the question is, with everything that's going on, with life as we know it today, here in 2021, I want to ask a very serious question. Are you supposed to have peace and joy in today's world? Is it even possible to have peace and joy in 2021? And of course, the emphatic answer is yes. Peace and joy are the results of living a life in Christ. They are not based on what is happening around us. God has given us peace and joy. He gave them to us. He gave them to us as benefits of having a relationship, a personal relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. But it's important that we understand what we're talking about, because peace is not the absence of conflict. It is the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. That's what peace is all about. And joy is not happiness. We know that happiness is temporary. It's completely dependent on what's happening around you in any given moment. Sometimes things that are happening around us make us sad, make us not happy. But that's not joy. Happiness focuses on the day, on the events of the day, while joy focuses on the person of the Jesus Christ, our Savior. Joy is a gift that comes from the Holy Spirit. So that's what I want to imply to you today, if you haven't already caught the drift, if you didn't know, we can enjoy peace and embrace joy in the presence of Jesus Christ. As I said, both of those are gifts from God. That's what God wants us to have. Look at what Jesus said. He said, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be made full." David, when he was confessing his sins after committing adultery with Bathsheba, he confessed it to God, and this is how he prayed. This is the request. He said, "To God, restore to me the joy of thy salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit." Jesus said, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world." Holy Spirit, speaking through Paul, said these words, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." And then, of course, one of the most famous verses on peace, and the personal favorite of many people, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." You see, Jesus and God want us to have and experience peace and joy. Today, what I want to do is show you four actions that you can take so that you can not only live in joy and peace, but so that you can flourish, embrace, and enjoy a life of joy and peace with God. Now, keep in mind when we talk about these four actions today, none of them are prioritized. It's not saying that the first one's most important or second. None of them are prioritized. They're all equally important. You must do all four, all day, every day, and the result will be a life of joy and peace. So the first action that I want you to see is to linger in gratitude. We've all prayed fervently for something. It may, no matter what the specific item is, it could have been a health issue, it could have been a financial issue, it could have been a salvation issue, it could be praying for restoration of a family relationship because of rebellious children. Whatever it is, we pray, and we pray, and we pray fervently for that, for whatever that something is that we need or we want or desire. And if it's God's will, He will answer that prayer at the perfect time. And what do you do when you receive that prayer then? I mean, that answer to that prayer. You respond joyfully and thankfully. And that's good. But the problem is, after we thank God for answering that prayer, our tendency is to move on to something else. God, that's a good thing to do. Be thankful for the answered prayer. But God wants us to thank Him and not move on. God wants us to remain for a while in a period of sustained gratitude. Listen to what it says in Colossians. It says, "As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him, having been firmly rooted and now being built up in Him and established in your faith, just as you were instructed, and overflowing with gratitude." I want you to focus on those last three words, overflowing with gratitude. And that ought to be a characteristic of our lifestyle. We linger in gratitude. Instead of just experiencing a short-lived burst of gratitude, let this pleasure of thankfulness flow freely as you recall all that God has done for you. And you know one of the best ways to linger in gratitude? Tell other people what God's done for you. You know, we should be giving what I call praise reports all the time. God is constantly doing things for us, and that's great, but we need to tell somebody about it. Not only will it bless you, but it will also encourage others. But more importantly, it pleases God. Again, look at the Old Testament verse in 1 Chronicles. It says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon His name, make known His deeds among the people." Look, God wants every one of us to continue to bring our gratitude to Him. What is it that when we linger in gratitude, what are we being thankful for? Man, thank Him for the gift, the free gift of eternal life that He has given us through His Son, Jesus Christ. Thank Him for the things He's done for us, showering us with blessings, providing for our every need, protecting us from both known and unknown dangers. Thank Him for being the God that He is. Thank Him for loving us the way that He does, in spite of ourselves. You ever thought about it? God knows us perfectly. He knows us inside and out. He knows everything we do, everything we don't do, and He knows the motivation and the attitude behind it all. And in spite of all that, He still loves us. This perfect, unconditional love. We've got so much to thank Him for. That's why David wrote it this way. Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to Him with psalms. We got reason to be shouting to God. He has saved us from eternal damnation by sending His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's in addition to everything else He's ever done. Look, if God's never done anything for you, you ain't got no reason to shout. But if He's done even one thing, you ought to be shouting. And we know that God has done much, much more than that. God don't want doubting Christians. He wants shouting Christians. That is how we linger in gratitude. Why is it we just sit there and act like God never done anything for us? Our thankfulness and our attitude of gratitude will bless us doubly. It blesses us with happy memories of every time we think about the answered prayer that He has given us, but it also blesses us with the delight of sharing God's kingdom that is not shaken by the decisions or trends of society or government. Look, I can't answer what's going on, but I can tell you this, God is still on the throne, He's still in control, and one day we're going to see the victory come in spite of what everybody's trying to do in government and in the far left. We got reason to be thankful. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service. That word acceptable really is better translated in English as reasonable. Offer to God a reasonable service with reverence and awe. So the first action that you need to take to live a life of peace and joy is to linger in gratitude. Second action, do not worry. Now my Aunt Dot, she was one of my favorite aunts. She was just a fantastic lady. But she had one major negative characteristic. She was a worrywart. In fact, she is the champion of worrywarts. No matter what was happening around her, Aunt Dot was always seemed to be frazzled and frantic. If I heard her once, I heard her say 1,000 times, "I'm just a nervous wreck." Now, when I first started hearing that as a little boy, I had no idea what she meant. But that's what she always said. Well, one particular time when she was at our house, we were out playing. I was about 4, maybe 5 years old, and I got bit by my neighbor's dog. And I got bit rather badly. In fact, he sunk his teeth very deeply into my thigh. and it was bleeding profusely. Mama was getting ready to take me to the hospital so that she, because we knew it was going to have to require stitches maybe or something, but the bleeding wouldn't stop. While she was getting ready, Aunt Dot had me sitting on the bathroom. She picked me up and set me on the bathroom counter trying to get me all cleaned up. And I remember it just as clearly as it was yesterday, looking at her and saying in my innocent little four-year-old voice, "I'm a nervous wreck." Do not worry. And probably the most famous passage of Scripture on this particular topic is Jesus talking when he gave his Sermon on the Mount. Look at these verses, from selected verses from chapter 6. "Do not worry for your life as to what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor for your body as to what you shall put on. And which of you by worrying can add a single cubit to his lifespan? Do not worry." Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. Now, I want you to look at those verses. I want you to look very carefully, because I want you to notice one important detail about this familiar passage of Scripture. This is a command. Jesus said, "You know, you really shouldn't worry. Yeah, why don't you not worry?" He didn't say any of that. He said, "Do not worry." Three times in those few verses, he issued that command, "Do not worry." Now, this is a command not to burden us or to condemn us. On the contrary, it's a very gracious command that is given to set us free from worldly cares. You know, in the extended part of this passage that we just quoted from, Jesus was talking about how God feeds the birds of the air even though they don't plant any crops. He talks about how he clothes the lilies of the field in great splendor. And he says in that passage, he asks a rhetorical question. Since God loves us more than birds and flowers, how much more will he provide us everything that we need? And then Jesus reminds us in verse 32 that our Heavenly Father knows everything that we need. So instead of worrying, he tells us to seek his kingdom and his righteousness, because verse 33 says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." As you do, your perspective changes. As you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, everything changes. Worldly pursuits become secondary to advancing the kingdom of God and advancing your personal relationship with him and becoming more like him. So instead of worrying, spend your time and energy in developing your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Paul said it this way, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." In other words, worry about nothing, pray about everything. Do not worry. It's a command from Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus taught us that if we love him, we will obey his commands. Isn't that what he said? If you love me, you will keep my commands. So logic dictates that if we worry, we're not keeping his command. And if we're not keeping his command, obviously at that moment we don't love him. You know what else we do when we worry? We're sitting there saying to God, "God, you can't handle this problem. You need me to help you fix it." Now, which of us would have the audacity to even suggest that? But that's exactly what we do when we were created to enjoy the presence of God. in the present, in the now, in the day, today, as we entrust our future into His care and into His hands. Worry will shorten our life and will rob us of the joy and peace in which God wants us to flourish in His presence. So if you want to live a life of peace and joy, linger in gratitude and do not worry. But there's a third action. Suffer well. Now let me explain. Look, every one of us are a child of God. Someday, our faith will become sight, and we will see God as He really is. And we will not only see Him as He really is, we're going to be just like Him. But until that day comes, every one of us are still under construction. In fact, John said it this way in 1 John. He said, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as of yet what we shall be. We know that when He appears, we shall be like Him, because we will see Him just as He is." Although in Christ today you are a new creation and you are being conformed to His image, it doesn't erase the essence of who you are. But the good news is that you have identified with Jesus and you're becoming more and more like Him. That tells us quite simply, while our future is secure and glorious, while the penalty of sin has been completely removed forever, your present is not always going to be easy. Hardships await. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Paul said it this way in Romans 8. "The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, heirs also, heir of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him in order that we might also be glorified with Him." Jesus said it this way, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men cast insults at you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you on account of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great." So what are these two texts teaching us? They're teaching us that we are a member of the family of God. We are a child of God. Therefore, we are a fellow heir with Christ. That means we're going to share His inheritance. We're going to share His glory. That's good news. However, there's another side to that coin. If we are going to share Christ's glory, then we also must share His suffering. He said, "You will be persecuted. You will face hardship. You will suffer on account of me." So if we're going to share in His suffering, you know what we ought to do? Suffer well. Suffer well. Polycarp was a Christian of the very first century. He was martyred by the Romans because he refused to denounce Christ and worship Caesar. At the age of 80, he was burned at the stake. In the midst of all the fire engulfing him, everyone around him heard him cry out from the fire, praising God that he was found worthy to suffer for Jesus Christ. Suffer. We're going to suffer. So suffer well. Knowing you're going to suffer, knowing you're going to face persecution, search for Jesus in the midst of your struggles and in the midst of the hard times. In other words, suffer well. Ask Jesus to help you suffer well in a manner worthy of the King's household. Everything you endure will help you become more like Jesus if you learn to suffer well. Now, when I talk about suffering well, in my mind, a picture of a woman in labor comes to my mind. The process of her giving birth. During that labor, she endures intense pain, almost to the point of pain, the pain being unbearable. And as one labor pain abates, there's a brief period of respite comes. But then shortly, here comes another pain, even more intense, and coming at a quicker pace. The pain arrives stronger and stronger and stronger. And in that delivery room, or in that wherever she happens to be, there's much crying and screaming because of the suffering she endures. But then the baby is born. And in spite of all of the blood, sweat, and tears, every bit of that turns to joy because she's holding her newborn baby. Suffer well. Remember, the ultimate goal is what David said in Psalm 17. As for me, I shall behold thy face in righteousness. I will be satisfied with thy likeness when I awake. So while we're here on this earth facing all of the stuff that we have to face, if we want to live a life of peace and joy, we must linger in gratitude. We must not worry. We must suffer well. But there's a fourth one. Fourth action that Jesus tells us to take to have that peace and joy. Do not fear. Listen to what God told the prophet Isaiah. He said, "Thus says the Lord, who made you and formed you from the womb, who will help you. Do not fear, O Jacob, my servant." Are you ever realize God's been involved in your life even from before you were born? Because you are His child, you can count on His promise to help you and be with you as you journey on this earth, no matter what situation you're facing. Let me remind you of some of the promises that God has given us throughout His Word. Again, to Isaiah 41:10, He said, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And everybody remembers what He told Joshua. He said, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Do not fear. We have absolutely nothing to fear. No matter what we face, no matter how strongly the enemy opposes us, we gain victory by trusting in God. Again, David wrote in the Psalms, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth should change, though the mountains slip into the sea, no matter what's going on around us, no matter if the whole world is falling apart, and it is, we will not fear because God is our refuge. God is our strength. He is our ever-present help." God loves us more than you'll ever realize. He loves us more than I can. It's beyond comprehension how He loves us and how much. Do you realize that God is head over heels in love with you? We say, "For God so loved the world." Yes, He loves the world, but He knows you by name. He loves you. You got a personal relationship with Him. And because of that perfect love with which God loves you, there is absolutely no room for fear in your life, nor is there no need for it. The Bible teaches us that there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear because fear involves punishment. And the one who fears is not perfected in love. Jesus said it this way many, many times while He was here on this earth. "Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful." When we focus on the circumstances that are around us, when we try to control every detail of our life, weeds of worry and fear quickly spring up and choke the life out of us. No matter what you're facing, no matter what the problem is, no matter what storm you're facing, there are only two ways to respond to a storm. You respond in fear or you respond in faith. You can't do both. You respond in fear or you respond in faith. What's the difference? Fear focuses on the storm. Faith focuses on the Savior. When you find yourself afraid, turn away from the storm and turn to the Savior, the one who is lovingly present with you at every stage of life. Lean hard on His presence. Trust Him to help you today and all the days of your life. Listen to His words of comfort as He whispers in your ear. Listen to what He's saying. This passage in Isaiah happens to be my most favorite passage of all of the Bible. And it's one that I go to quite often when I'm facing a storm. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Now, I want you to notice in that passage, God didn't say that we were never going to be in a fire. God never said that we were going to be in floodwaters up to our neck. He said, but when you are, they will not overtake you. You will not drown. You will not burn because I am there. I have redeemed you, called you by name. You are mine. So can you have peace and joy during difficult, trying times when your circumstances seem unmanageable, when you don't have any idea what's going to happen, when you don't know what to do? Can you? Yes, you can. You can experience a profound and reassuring peace with overflowing joy despite what's happening around you. For you see, peace and joy is based on the security we have as a child of God. So to live a life of peace and joy, linger in gratitude, do not worry, suffer well, do not fear. These four actions, they will not guarantee you that you're never going to have troubles or tribulations ever again, because you are. But they will guarantee that you will not lose your joy. You will not lose your peace. They will enable you to enjoy peace and embrace joy in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, who will never leave you nor ever forsake you. And so, when you do this, you can truly say, "It is well with my soul." Father God, we know that we're living in troubled times. Lord, we know that your presence on earth is being strongly attacked. We know that there's spiritual war going on, but we know you've already won the battle. And so we know that you have given to us permanent joy and peace because of our relationship with you. And Father, that is why we can say, "It is well," in spite of the storm raging around us. Father, right now, as people are listening to this message, wherever they may be, many of them are facing personal storms. But help us to remember that even though the world around us seems to be crumbling, even though the storm is approaching and hitting us with full fury, because of the fact that we are a child of yours, your joy and your peace remain constant. Father, right now, I simply pray for each person, whether we're looking at a societal problem or whether they're facing a personal problem. May they feel your presence like they've never felt or experienced before. And in spite of the storm, with all the winds and the rains and all the howling and thunder and lightning, may we be able to say, with a smile on our face, it is well with my soul. And it is well because of you. Father, may your Holy Spirit speak to the hearts of each one. May they respond in whatever way you're calling them. Some need to respond by accepting you as Lord and Savior. Some need to respond by renewing and rededicating their life for you. Some need to respond by simply putting their trust in you in the specific situation of the storm they face. So may they turn from the storm, turn to you, and run to your open arms. Your will be done, Father. For this we pray in your name. Amen. The altar is open. You come as we stand together and we sing. We'll see y'all Wednesday night.